Hi everyone, I'm Jerry Schumann, pastor here at Ludlow Baptist Church. Thank you for joining us today. We hope that this video blesses and encourages you in your faith. And please consider sharing this on social media. Doing so is a strategic way that we're able to share the gospel with other people today. But before we begin, please keep this in mind. This video is not intended to be, and really it cannot be, a replacement for your commitment to a local church. God commands his people to gather regularly for worship and for fellowship under the leadership and the care of godly elders, where the whole body is knit together, and that's how the body grows and builds itself up in love. So nothing online can be a replacement for that. So if you're in the area, come and join us for worship. We'd love to have you with us. If you're not nearby, please be sure that you're committed to a local, faithful, Bible-believing church. Thank you, and God bless.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to our worship service here this morning. Psalm 95, verses 6 and 7 says this: Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker, for he is our God. And oh, the grace of God, we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care. We are here today to worship God. And he is so, so worthy of our worship. If you have just an itsy-bitsy comprehension of who God is, just a little understanding of what he is like and what he has done for us, you understand this, of course, how worthy God is to be worshiped by us. In our men's Bible study, after our men's prayer group, every the first and third Saturday of each month, we have been studying the attributes of God. And what a sweet study that is, and what a valuable study. To look at the attributes of God, to understand better of what God is like. And I hope that we are all worshiping God personally, 24/7. But yesterday we were looking especially at the supremacy of God and the sovereignty of God, and how thankful we should be that God is supreme, that God is sovereign. But in addition to that, he is faithful, he is patient, he is merciful. He is unchanging. He, of course, is all-powerful and just. And how thankful we should be that he is holy and that he is a God of love. And in that holiness and love, he has provided redemption for you and I by sending his Son to be our Savior. That's what the angels were saying to the shepherds, right? For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And so, we worship him personally throughout the week. I hope when you're doing your Bible study, when you're praying, when you're meditating upon him, when you're talking to other people about him. But there's something special about coming together with fellow believers and worshiping him together, to acknowledge him, to pray together, to love him. There's something very, very special about that, of course. And again, if we think of the Christmas story, if we think of the wise men coming to Bethlehem to see the Christ child, and what was it they said? We have seen his star, and we have come to worship him. I hope that's why you are here today, that you have come to worship him. So we call to you to come and worship him. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, how we thank you for who you are. We thank you, Lord, for all that you do. We thank you, Lord, for all that you have done. We thank you, Lord, for those wonderful, beautiful, sensational attributes of you. And Lord, how we thank you that you have given us the faith to believe that this is not simply something that we read in your word or somewhere else, but that we know in our hearts that you are all this. And so, Lord, we come and worship you and thank you for all that you do. For I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let her receive her King. Let every heart prepare in room, and heaven and nature sing.
second coming, when he will fully reign over the earth, and we will see his glory unclouded by sin. Praise God for that expectation that we have. You may be seated.
Advent, we've been looking at four symbols used by the early church that remind us of the character and work of Jesus Christ, whose coming we celebrate this Advent season. The first week, our symbol was the shepherd's staff, which reminds us that Jesus is the good shepherd. Last week, our symbol was a crown that reminds us that Jesus is the King of Kings. And this week, our symbol is the cornerstone. He's the foundation that the church is built on. Today, I have Sage and Cedar Hill as my helpers.
Ephesians 2:19 through 20. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the cornerstone.
So this week the ornament is a cornerstone. The ornaments are white and gold. The white stands for purity and righteousness of Christ. The gold stands for his royalty. And this week there is an Alpha and Omega, two letters from the Greek alphabet, embroidered on the cornerstone that stand for Christ's deity to remind us that he is the cornerstone.
May God add his blessing and understanding this morning as we look at 1 Peter 2, verses 1 through 10. Therefore, rid yourselves of all malice and all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander of every kind. Like newborn babies, crave pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow up in your salvation, and now that you've tasted that the Lord is good. As you come to him, the living stone, rejected by humans, but chosen by God and precious to him, you also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For in Scripture it says, "See, I lay a stone in Zion, a chosen and precious cornerstone, and the one who trusts in him will never be put to shame." Now to you who believe, this stone is precious, but to those who do not believe, the stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone, and a stone that causes people to stumble, and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the message, which is also what they were destined for. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. This is the word of the Lord. You may be seated.
Let's pray and ask God's blessing as we look at this word today. Our Father, as we come to your word, we first off come with gratitude that you have given to us such a wonderful gift in your word that reveals to us your will to us. It reveals to us your plan of salvation. It reveals to us Christ. Help us, Father, to never become numb to your word, but help us to always treasure it and to value it. Father, we also pray that as we look at your word today, that you might give us eyes to see more of Christ today, that we might see who he is, that we might see him as a chosen and precious cornerstone. And Father, we pray that you might help us to see the identity that we have in Christ, the high calling that we've received in Christ. Help us then, in light of that, to live faithfully with the high calling that we've received. So we just commit this time to you. Do immeasurably more than all we can ask or imagine. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, during this Christmas time, for us as Christians, Christmas time ought never to be a season of the bah humbugs for us. It ought always to be a season of joyous celebration. And it ought to be this, not because we are ignoring the hardships and trials in our lives. We have hardships and we have trials, and there are seasons where we go through a lot of hardships and trials. But it ought to be a time of joy celebration because we see the glory of the one whom we're celebrating at this time of year. One of the passages I think that encapsulates the glory of what happened 2023 some odd years ago is John 1:14, where it says, "The Word became flesh and dwelt among us." Now, in the Gospel of John, by the time he's gotten up to verse 14, we've learned quite a bit about the glory of this Word. We've learned that this Word is eternal. In the beginning was this Word. We've learned that this Word has forever been in fellowship with God. The Word was with God.
We've learned that this word is divine. This word was God. We've also learned that this word is the creator of all things. All things were made through this word, and without him was not anything made that was made. This word is eternal, God, with God forever, and creator of all things. And then we read verse 14, and this word became flesh and dwelt among us. This eternal, divine, creator word became truly man like us in every respect. When Jesus, the eternal Son of God, came to earth, his humanity was not an illusion. He didn't put on a bodysuit when he came to earth. He became like us, God's word says, in every respect. The one who created the Milky Way galaxy became a microscopic zygote in Mary's womb. The one who has life in himself nursed at his mother's breast. The one who knows all things grew in wisdom. How do we comprehend these things? This is he who was born of a virgin and placed in a manger 2,000 years ago. The one who is truly God and also truly man. And it says the word became flesh and dwelt among us. And that Greek word there for dwell, it doesn't simply mean live. It means tabernacle. This eternal divine word became flesh and tabernacled among us. The greatest privilege that Israel had in the Old Testament was that the holy God dwelt in their midst. He dwelt first in the tabernacle and then later in the temple. So what does it mean for Jesus, the eternal word, to tabernacle among us? It means that the dwelling place of God is no longer in an earthly tent. It's no longer in a temple made of stone. It's found in Jesus, the one born in Bethlehem 2,000 years ago. The Word became flesh and tabernacled among us. Now, to understand why this is such glorious news, if we stopped here, this is amazing news, astounding news, incredible news. But we can't stop there, can we? When we're thinking about the incarnation, we can't just stop with the what of the incarnation. We always need to move on to the why of the incarnation. We can't just say, well, what happened? That's glorious in itself. But we need to look at, well, why did it happen? Why did this glorious miracle take place? Put it this way. The incarnation is not some divine fireworks display that God set before us. It's awesome. It's impressive. But it's out there and it doesn't really affect us. No, what we see in our passage in 1 Peter 2 is that the incarnation, one way of looking at it is, it's a divine building project. It's this cosmic building project that our triune God had ordained before time began, that his son would come to earth and he as the cornerstone would build this glorious house for himself. This is what it means for Christ to be the cornerstone, the divine word tabernacled among us to build something glorious on earth, that we as believers in Christ are ushered up into the glories that he brings. So as we're looking at 1 Peter 2 today, we'll be looking primarily at verses 4 and 5, only two verses. But we're going to see four truths about what it means for Christ to be the cornerstone, so that you might see more of the amazing salvation that we have in Christ Jesus. So here's the first amazing truth. Jesus is the living cornerstone who is the foundation of life for all. Verse 4 says this. If you see in 1 Peter 2, verse 4. As you come to him, speaking of Jesus, a living stone. Isn't that a striking title? As you come to him, a living stone. This is certainly a mixed metaphor, isn't it? Because stones aren't alive. Stones are inanimate objects. But this stone is alive. Now, it might seem degrading at first for Peter to refer to Christ as a stone. Is that belittling of Christ? Well, no, because Peter's not thinking of a pebble at a beach. He's thinking of a cornerstone, the cornerstone in the temple. Look down at verse 6. He quotes Isaiah 28:16, which says, "Behold, I'm laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone chosen and precious." So that's what he's thinking of by calling Christ a living stone. He's speaking of him as being the cornerstone in the temple of God. Now, we know that the temple in Jesus' day was an oppressive structure. In Mark 13:1, we read that as Jesus and his followers were exiting the temple, they looked back at the temple and the temple grounds, the temple structure, and the disciples said, "Look, teacher, what wonderful stones, what wonderful buildings." The temple was a majestic building. The temple itself was 172 feet wide, 172 feet long, and 172 feet high. Just think of how huge that would be. That's 16 stories, 17 stories. On top, or surrounding the temple, was this the massive temple grounds. It contained the walls and other structures on the Temple Mount here. And the temple grounds were in themselves incredible. It spanned a distance of 1,000 feet wide by 1,500 feet long. Its foundational walls were constructed of these gigantic stones, the largest measuring, get this, 45 feet long by 11.5 feet high by 12 feet thick. No wonder the disciples said, "Look at these amazing stones, look at these amazing buildings." But Jesus, as the living stone, far exceeds the glory of the earthly temple. As I mentioned earlier, the tabernacle and the temple in the Old Covenant, they were just a foreshadow of the greater dwelling place of God to come, which is Jesus Christ. Because the fullness of God dwells in bodily form in the person of Christ, and Jesus is Emmanuel, God with us, therefore he is the temple, the dwelling place of God in our midst. And this is why for the ornament here, it's so perfect that there's the Alpha and the Omega in the cornerstone. It's precisely because Jesus is truly God and took on flesh that he is the true temple. He is the cornerstone. Now, as the true temple, a question we should be asking is this. If God's a holy God, and if evil cannot dwell in his midst, Habakkuk 1:14 says, God is of pure eyes than to look upon sin. And we are all sinners by nature and by choice. Then how can we be able to dwell with God because of our sin? Well, Jesus said this in John 2:19. He said, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." And he wasn't speaking of the earthly temple, he was speaking of his body. When Jesus was crucified on the cross, he shed his blood to make atonement for sin. 3 days later, Jesus rose again from the dead, never to die again. Therefore, Jesus is the true and ultimate temple. He is where we go to meet God. He is a living stone. He has been raised from the dead. By virtue of his resurrection, Jesus has conquered over sin. He's conquered over the devil. He's conquered over death. All these are things that keep us from God. Sin, death, the devil. By virtue of his resurrection, he has conquered over these things. And by faith in Christ, we can now have access to God. And because Jesus has been raised from the dead, this shows us that Jesus has a life in himself. And anyone that comes to him, as we'll see in a little bit here, anyone that comes to Christ by faith, that we partake of his life. We receive his life. So, what then does it mean, verse 4, for Jesus to be this living stone, for him to be this cornerstone? Well, some have suggested that what's being emphasized here is that it's Christ who brings together humanity. He's the one who brings together Jew and Greek by his work on the cross. He's the one who unites us, and he's the Prince of Peace bringing humanity together. And he then is the cornerstone, just as a cornerstone brings together two walls. So is that what's meant by him being the cornerstone? Well, it's true that it is Christ's blood that reconciles Jew and Gentile. His blood has broken down the dividing wall of hostility, and he's made into one man the two men that were in alienation to one another. We read about that in Ephesians 5. But that's not what it means for Christ to be the cornerstone. A cornerstone is not fundamentally something that brings two walls together. A cornerstone is something that supports the whole structure. A cornerstone is a foundation. Because in Bible times, a building was built upon this large stone, this foundational stone, so that the whole structure rested upon it. The temple that God is building then is built only on Christ. And if we would have life and salvation, that can only be found in who? It's in Christ. Life is found in Christ. Look at how Peter interprets this, Christ being the cornerstone, in another passage. Go back to Acts chapter 4, where Peter is speaking to the religious leaders. He and John have been brought before him because by the power of Jesus, they healed a lame man. And the religious leaders are not pleased. And they say, by what power did you do this? And look at what Peter says to the religious leaders in verses 10 through 12. Acts 4, 10 through 12. Let it be known to you, to all of you, and to all the people of Israel, that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him this man is standing before you well. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone. And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. Do you see how verse 11 and verse 12 are connected? Jesus is this cornerstone, rejected by you, God's raised from the dead, and there's salvation in no one else except for Christ. That's what it means for him to be the cornerstone. You know, it's very common today for people to say, there are many paths to God. There are many ways to God. There's Muhammad. You can follow the teachings of Muhammad. Or there's Buddha. You can follow the teachings of Buddha. There's New Age theology. There's Judaism. There's just being a good person, just being a good moral person. And it doesn't really matter what path you choose as long as you're sincere. If you're sincere and you do your best, then you can be able to work your way to God, to have access to God. But friend, the Bible speaks against this in the strongest of terms. There is salvation in no one else, in no other name except for Christ. Well, you might ask, well, why? Why is that the case? It's because Christ alone is the cornerstone. By virtue of him being the God-man, by virtue of him laying down his life for sinners, by virtue of him triumphing over death on the third day, by him accomplishing salvation, the only way that we can dwell with God is by building our lives on this chief cornerstone. And if we reject this chief cornerstone and we go anywhere else and build on anything else, we have rejected the only source of salvation. The only way that we can be forgiven and reconciled with God is by building our lives on the chief cornerstone. Matthew Henry says this, Jesus Christ is the very foundation stone of all of our hopes and happiness. So for Christ to be the chief cornerstone means that life and salvation and eternal hope is found only in Christ. Here's the second truth that we see in 1 Peter 2. There are radically different responses to this cornerstone. Now, without having read this passage beforehand, if you'd hear this about Christ being the cornerstone, that he is eternal, that he is divine, that he is the Alpha and Omega, that he is this Word who has dwelt among us, he's just this cornerstone, you'd think, who would reject him? Who would oppose him? And yet we see that's exactly what happened. Look at verse 4. As you come to him, a living stone rejected by men. Now, the Greek word here for rejected, it's a perfect tense participle, which speaks of a completed action in the past with ongoing effects to this day. Now, that's important to keep in mind because when Peter is speaking of this stone being rejected by men, he's not thinking in the first place of how when he's writing this letter of others that are rejecting Christ. He's thinking of a past action, a past rejection of Christ. What rejection of Christ do you think he's thinking of? He's thinking of what happened decades earlier when Jesus was rejected by the religious leaders and crucified on the cross. The reason we know this, if you look at verse 7, Peter quotes another passage, Psalm 118, 22, and says this, "The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone." It's the builders. And who are the builders? It's the religious leaders back in Jesus' day. As the religious leaders, they were commanded by God to be caring for the people of God spiritually and building them up. They're the builders. And they came upon this precious cornerstone and they said, we reject him. We despise him. he's worthy only of being crucified, rejected by men. Keep your finger here. Go back to Matthew 21. I want you to see another passage where we see this is who this passage is thinking of. It's thinking of these religious leaders, the builders. Matthew 21 shows us another passage that teaches this. So this comes right at the end of the parable of the tenants. And Jesus says this in chapter 21, verse 42. It says, "Have you never read in the scriptures, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone? This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes." And then look at verse 45. "When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables, they perceived that he was speaking about them." They knew that he was speaking about them. The builders that the stone rejected, it was going to be them who is going to reject them. So when it says rejected by men, it's speaking of, in the first place, the religious leaders who were to be the builders of the people of God, who came upon this cornerstone and they said, "No, thank you." That should be striking to all of us, because if you have a carpenter, someone working in construction, many of you are working in construction. So if we had Tom, or if we had Ryan, that they're working in construction, and you're kind of tagging along, helping out, and they come across some foundational, they come across some bricks, or they come across some lumber, and they say, this is terrible, this is awful, and they send it back to Home Depot. If you're tagging along, what are you going to think? You're going to trust their opinion, right? You're going to say, they know best. Yeah, this is awful, it's terrible. And so we could be tempted to think, if the religious leaders rejected the cornerstone, then this cornerstone must be of no value. But look what else it says in chapter 2. Rejected by men, but in the sight of God, chosen and precious. What a contrast. The builders saw nothing in Christ, but God viewed Christ as chosen and precious. The Greek word here for chosen, it means considered best, choicest, or excellent. And the Greek word for precious, it means something of considerable worth, valuable. So the builders, they despised Christ. They saw him as unworthy. God the Father looked upon Christ and viewed him as excellent and exceedingly valuable. Now, when was this pleasure that God the Father looked upon Christ? When did this happen? Maybe it was when Christ was born and he sent that angelic host to the shepherds to sing glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men. Maybe that's when God displayed his favor upon Christ. Or maybe it was at his baptism or his transfiguration, when God the Father audibly spoke so that mankind could hear. And in each case, it was very similar. He said, "This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased." Was that when God the Father demonstrated his favor upon this cornerstone, that he is chosen and precious? Well, he certainly is showing his favor in those instances, but that's not when he demonstrated it supremely. That's not what Peter's thinking of. The delight that's spoken of here is when God raised his Son from the dead. Listen again to what Peter says in Acts chapter 4, verses 10 and 11. Go back there. We read it quickly, but notice what he says. Acts 4, 10 and 11. "Let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified." So there is the builders rejecting the stone, right? "Whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead. By him, this man is standing before you. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone." Verses 11 and 10 are parallel. You have the rejection of the stone by the builders. That is verse 11, the stone being rejected. You have Jesus being raised from the dead. That is God establishing Christ as the cornerstone. God demonstrated his favor upon Christ when he raised him from the dead. He demonstrated his pleasure upon the person and work of Christ by raising him from the dead. So if you ask yourself, how can I know that this is true, that Christ is actually the cornerstone, that he is the dwelling place of God, that he's the only one in whom life and salvation is found? Friend, look no further than the resurrection. The resurrection is God the Father's declaration that Jesus is the dwelling place of God, and he is the cornerstone. The resurrection is God the Father's authoritative declaration that his favor and delight is upon Christ. The builders rejected Christ. God raised him from the dead because death could not contain him, because he is righteous. So these diverse responses here to the cornerstone, God the Father's pleasure is upon Christ, showing that he is indeed the chief cornerstone and the only source of life. Here's the third truth. Those built on Christ the cornerstone become a holy temple and priesthood. So here we see how the incarnation, the work of Christ, is driven home. Look at verse 5. You yourselves, like living stones, are being built up into a spiritual house. So notice two things. Notice first that we as believers are called living stones. Christ is the living stone. He's the cornerstone. We also are living stones. How do we become living stones? Verse 4, as you come to him. It's by faith. It's by faith in Christ. It's not by our good works. It's not by our religious performance. It's by faith in Christ that we are united to Christ. And because he is this living stone, the source of life, by faith in him, we then partake of his life. It's hard to even give a metaphor for this, but it's like this living, animate living stone or cornerstone has been set down, and then this dead stone is placed upon it. And when it's placed upon it, then it comes to life. We are living stones. We have been made spiritually alive as we come to Christ by faith. The second thing I want you to see is look how we're built up into this glorious house. We're being built up as a spiritual house. What's he talking about here? He's talking about the temple. We're being built up into a temple. All believers built upon Christ by faith are built into this awesome, spirit-filled temple, a dwelling place for God. It's true that when we trust in Christ, his spirit dwells within us, so that the Bible does speak of our bodies being a temple of the Lord. 1 Corinthians 6:19 says this, "Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit?" So we are individually, our body is the temple of the Lord. But when Scripture speaks, when the New Testament speaks of the temple of God, it far more often speaks of how we as saints together are the temple of God, the corporate identity as believers. Listen to these passages. 2 Corinthians 6:16. We are the temple of the living God, Paul says. 1 Corinthians 3:16, Paul says to the Corinthian church, "Do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in you?" And the word for you, both those words for you, they're both plural. He's speaking about the whole Corinthian church. You are the temple. Ephesians 2:21, the passage I was read earlier, says that believers, that as they're built upon Christ, the cornerstone, that, quote, "in whom the whole structure being joined together grows into a holy temple in the Lord." It's all believers together. We're growing into a holy temple for the Lord. So this is God's glorious design. God's design is not to build a temple of individual believers. It's one stone on top of the cornerstone. Wouldn't it be very impressive? God's design is that billions and billions of living stones throughout the ages, built on the chief cornerstone, grows into this holy, awesome temple for the living God. God's aim is not so much to magnify his glory in individual believers as it is the church built together. These stones place upon one another so that the church is a dwelling place for God. And look also at how we're made a holy priesthood. Look at verse 5. To be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Now, in the Old Covenant, only a very select group of people could be the priests. It was only those descended from Aaron in the tribe of Levi, and only men descended from Aaron from the tribe of Levi could serve as priests. But here in the new covenant in Christ Jesus, we're told it's everybody. It's all believers. This is the priesthood of all believers. Well, what does it mean for us to be a priesthood? Well, it means a few things. It means as a priesthood, we are set apart holy as unto the Lord, just as the priests were set apart holy as unto the Lord for his service. It also means that as the priests, as they had that privilege of dwelling in the presence of God in the tabernacle and temple, that all of us, because of our great high priest, we all have that privilege of dwelling in the presence of God. We have communion with God. It also means that as the priests offered up sacrifices to God, that was part of their duty, that all of us are to offer up sacrifices to God. The sacrifices are not animals that we're offering up. We're not offering up bulls and goats. It says in verse 5, we are a holy priesthood to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. So they're spiritual sacrifices. Have you thought of that before? You are a holy priesthood set apart to God, and your calling as a priest is to continually offer up sacrifices to God that are pleasing to God. You might say, well, what does that mean? Well, it begins with you offering up yourself to God, all that you are. Romans 12:1 says, present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. It's saying, God, my body belongs to you. Everything that I do this day, I want to be pleasing to you. I want you to look upon this living sacrifice, and I want you to be glorified. And then from there, it leads to offering up sacrifices of prayers to God. When we pray to God and praise Him and cry out to Him and lift our intercessions to God, did you know that's a spiritual sacrifice to God? As we give of our money to the Lord, God says He loves a cheerful giver. As we give to the ministry of the church, as we give to support the gospel advance, that's a sacrifice to God that God is pleased with. As we give our thanksgiving to God, give our obedience, our praises, our good works, all these things as we offer to God through Christ, they are pleasing to God. Now, what we need to see is we just take a pause here. We just step back. How much more glorious is the work of God in the new covenant than the old covenant? The disciples, they looked at the structure of the old covenant and said, what amazing stones, what amazing buildings. But the glory that God has done in Christ, isn't it far greater? The temple in the new covenant is not made of dead stones, but living stones, us, who share life in Christ. The priesthood is not limited to a small number of people who are still so limited from the presence of God, but all believers have access to God and offer our sacrifices to God on a daily basis. How much greater is the glory of the new covenant than the old covenant? Look at the final truth here, and that's this. These truths here about Christ being the cornerstone, they are rooted in God's prophesied, unshakable word. So Peter, he's taught these doctrines here in verses 4 and 5, and then he quotes three verses from the Old Testament to prove that these are so. In verse 6, he quotes from Isaiah 28:16, which says, behold, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame. In verse 7, he says, so the honor is for you who believe, but for those who do not believe. And then he quotes from Psalm 118:22, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. And in verse 8, he quotes from Isaiah 8:14, which says, a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. So do you see what Peter's saying here? He's saying that our confidence for believing that Jesus is the cornerstone, it's not only found in the resurrection, it's not only found in the atoning work of Christ, but it's found in God's unshakable word. God prophesied in the case of Isaiah 700 years beforehand. In the case of the psalmist, we don't know who wrote it. There's no name on the superscription, but maybe around the time of David, 1,000 years earlier, God prophesied earlier that he would lay in Zion a cornerstone. Those who believe in this stone would be saved. And though this stone would be rejected by the builders and be a stone of stumbling for them unto their destruction, it would be established by God as the cornerstone. What confidence you and I ought to have that Christ is the cornerstone, because God, in his prophesied word, declared that it would be so. And what do we know about God's word, brothers and sisters? We know Scripture cannot be broken. We know it's impossible for God to lie. We know Scripture cannot pass away. We know that God's prophesied word is the more sure word, and it is a lamp shining in a dark place. If God's word has declared it hundreds of years earlier, then you can take it to the bank. Christ is who God says he is. He is the cornerstone. So let me close with some words of application. And let me close by asking this question. How have you responded to this cornerstone? How have you responded to this cornerstone? What's your life built on? Is your life built on this living stone? Friend, only Christ is the one who's made atonement for sin. Only Christ can forgive you of your sin and reconcile you with God. Only Christ is the living one. Build your life on Christ, or you will perish in your sins. Only in Christ can you be built into this temple and have God dwell with you as being part of this temple. But if you reject Christ, you reject this cornerstone, and you remain in your sins, then God says you will perish eternally apart from the presence of God. You either build your life on Christ and enjoy the presence of God, or you reject Christ and you perish eternally from the presence of God. So friend, do not be like the builders. Don't reject Christ. They stumbled over this stone. They rejected this stone. And as a result, they were crushed by the stone. God's grace in Christ is offered to you freely today. Come to Christ. No matter your past, no matter your sins that you committed, no matter how you made a wreck of things in your life, come to Christ. Come to Christ by faith, trusting in Christ as your Savior and as your Lord. And you will be forgiven. You will be accepted as you come to this great cornerstone. He'll not cast aside anyone. Come to him by faith, and you'll be made alive, and God will dwell with you forever. So come to Christ. Build your life on Christ. And brothers and sisters, we ought to ask ourselves, are we living our lives in light of this glorious salvation? Are you living your life in light of the fact that Christ is this cornerstone and you're built upon him into this glorious temple made as a dwelling place for God? Do you conduct yourself in a way that's honoring to God in light of that? Do you prize the unity of believers in light of that? If we're stones built together with the mortar of the Holy Spirit, then what should our attitude be like towards other believers? You see, this is why God tells us, don't forsake the assembly of yourselves with one another. This is why God says, be devoted to the fellowship with one another. Because when we gather as the people of God, and when we are dwelling in fellowship, and when we gather together, and we lift our voices in praise to God, and we worship him as we gather together, what's that a foretaste of? In the future, when the temple is complete, when Jesus Christ comes back and he gathers all of his elect from every corner of the earth, and all the saints that have gone before us and their souls right now are with our Lord, and all the elect are with God, billions and billions, this innumerable multitude, and we are in the presence of God, and we praise God, and we enjoy the presence of God for all eternity, then this temple is complete. And every time we gather, that's a foretaste of it. If this is what Christ is doing, then how we should value life with one another as believers. How we should value the assembly with ourselves as believers. How we should value living a holy life. We are a holy temple. If we're a holy temple, then we ought to conduct ourselves in a way that's pleasing to God. So brothers and sisters, focus on the incarnation of Christ. Realize afresh that Christ came to build this temple of Christians knit together, and then live your lives in light of it, in light of this glorious salvation. Let's pray. So Father in heaven, we thank you and praise you for the incredible work of Christ, that he is this chief cornerstone. We rejoice, Father, for the great work that you have done, the great work that you have sent your own Son to earth, that he has done all the work needed that we can be reconciled with you and that you can dwell with us. So, Father, we praise you. We thank you. We are not worthy of these things, and we worship you. You are so awesome. Your salvation is so amazing. Help us, Father, to live our lives in light of it. We pray in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Before we close with the benediction, if you felt the Holy Spirit pointing you to Christ and leading you to Christ and wanting to build your life upon this cornerstone, I would be happy to talk with you, to pray with you. Chuck and Kevin as well would be happy to talk with you and pray with you. But today is the day of salvation, friend. Today is the day of salvation. If you are feeling this leading, this calling to Christ, and you see that the sufficiency is found in Christ, then turn to him today. Let's close with a benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give to you his peace, both now and forevermore. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen.